You have your copy of God's Word, I'd like for you to turn over to 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. We'll look at verses 15 through 17 this morning, Lord willing. The message this morning's a pretty heavy subject matter, one that's difficult to preach. It may be difficult for you to hear. Maybe some things I say this morning may embarrass you. But something needs to be preached today. The lack of preaching today is what's sending people to hell. Doctrinal preaching today is becoming very rare. Preaching what God's Word says today is becoming rare. People want to preach what man wants to hear and what man has to say. We're going to preach what God has to say and just let him take care of the fallout. How about that? 1 John chapter 2, verses 15 through 17. If you're able to stand, please stand for the reading of God's Word. 1 John chapter 2. Starting with verse 15. And here the Bible says, "Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, and the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof. But he that doeth the will of God abideth forever." Father, thank you for the reading of your word this morning. I'm praying now, God, you anoint me. Lord, you help me as I try to preach this message, Lord. And God, I know that your word won't be returned unto you void, God, but it will go out and it will accomplish what you please it to. And Lord, we're just praying for a mighty work to be done in your word today. Help us, Father, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You can be seated. According to Webster's 1828 dictionary, which is the one I use, I don't trust the new dictionaries, but the 1828 Webster's dictionary defines a human as the following. A human is belonging to man or mankind, pertaining or relating to the race of a man as a human voice, human shape, human nature, human knowledge, human life, having the qualities of a man, profane, not sacred or divine, as a human author. By show of hands this morning, I want to know who all in here is a human. Everybody that's a human, raise your hand. Who in here is not a human? Please raise your hand. I don't see anybody raising their hands on not a human. So everybody in here is a human, right? We can agree on this fact. So we've established something already. Every single person listening to this message right now at this moment is a human being. We all have human flesh. We're not an animal. We're not a terrestrial being. We're not some other life matter. We're not sacred. We're not divine. And we're not from outer space. We're a human being. God made us as a human. Well, since we're all human, we all have something in common with each other. We all have flesh. We all have human flesh, we have eyes, and we all have pride. Flesh, eyes, and pride. These are the three things that are the downfall of man. The three things that are instrumental in causing every man, every woman, and every child to sin. These three things cause sin. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. For the past 6 years, as I've been pastor here, I've kept a sticky note on my computer downstairs in the pastor's study. And it is this verse right here that says, "For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life is not of the Father, but is the world." I want a constant reminder that I am flesh and that given up into my flesh, if given over to myself, these things will be in my life. And I want that to be a constant reminder to me as I go through my day. In our opening text we just read, we find the Apostle John writing to the church. Yes, he's writing to save people here. Over in the Gospel of John, where we see John 3:16 and such, he's writing to the lost. He's writing so that you can understand who Jesus is and become saved. But when he writes his epistles of 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, he's writing to save people so that they may know that they are saved and how they are to live their life as a Christian. And so when John is speaking here and writing these things, he's writing it to people like you and I. If you say you're saved today, he's writing to you. You're a saved person and you're a human being. Well, John often is referred to as the apostle of love. There's many reasons for that. One is because he referred to himself as the one that Jesus loved. But he also wrote about love more than any other of the gospel writers. You'll find John writing about it all through his writings. But he speaks of things about the love of God and so on. And when we hear that word love, we think of the love of God and the love that God has for us. And we think of the love that a man has for a woman and vice versa, the love that parents have for children and vice versa. We think about these things in our human nature, this form of love that we have. And these are all good things. These are wonderful things. These are blessings that God has given us, this blessing of love. But here John is speaking about a different kind of love. And it's not a good love. It's not the kind of love that you want to have. And it's called the love, he said, the love of the world. The love of the world. And it's not good. If you're like me, when you grew up listening to preachers, we were those kids that were, what they call them, on drugs. They drug you to church all the time. They drug you to church every day, and every time the door was open, we were drugged to church. We were drug kids. And I'm so thankful for that today. I may not have been as I was a kid. I'm sure that I was complaining a lot about it. But I want you to know today that I am so thankful my parents drugged me to church when the door was open. Because without that, I would not have got saved. Without that, I wouldn't be the man that I am today. There's no telling where I might have been. I might be living in a gutter somewhere or sitting around smoking a crack pipe or shooting myself up with drugs or drinking myself to death. There's no telling what might have come of me. And so I'm thankful for that. But if you grew up like I did, hearing preachers preach, you hear the word worldly a lot. We used to. We heard that all the time. About any service you had, somebody talked about being worldly. You know, somebody living worldly. And you always wonder, well, what's that mean? Well, that means you're living like the world would live. You're living your life like a lost person would live. And when you hear that word worldly, someone said to me one time, not long ago, a younger person, they said, well, what exactly are you talking about not loving the world and the things in the world? Aren't trees and mountains and flowers in the world? Are we not supposed to love those? And then I got to realizing that things ain't like they used to be. People don't understand this terminology that we are so used to. And so we've got to break it down for folks. And so that they can understand what we're talking about. When you read your Bible, it says, love not the world, neither the things are in the world. And when you hear a preacher like myself saying that man is worldly or that is a worldly look or a worldly way of speaking or worldly music, we talk about that oftentimes. And usually in our home, I usually say it's of the devil is what I say. The kids will say something, and I say, well, that's of the devil, you know, or that song is of the devil. That book is of the devil. And you could term it the same way. It's of the world as well, because the devil and the world go hand in hand. And so the things of the world, what that means is, it's referring to things that Satan uses to entice, to attract, to tempt our flesh so that we will sin. That's what he is. The Bible calls him a tempter. Why is he called a tempter? Because he tempts us. He tempts our flesh, and he knows every little button to push on you. Trust me. He's been doing it for a long time, and he's brought down much bigger men and women than you or I. And the devil's very good at it. I want to look at these three things this morning quickly. The first one being the lust of the flesh. The lust of the flesh. The thing that makes us a human being. The flesh is more, though, than just meat beneath the skin. I remember back when I was in the seventh grade and I was running through the schoolyard and I fell down on some slick grass and my hand went down on a very sharp rock and it cut my hand open right here. And I had to have several stitches, but I went up to the nurse or the secretary in the principal's office and I slammed my bloody hand down on the counter and blood flew all over the place and she gagged. And you could see the flesh coming out of my finger right there. It was just coming out. A human being is made up of this flesh, but it's much more than that. The Bible's not speaking specifically about the meat underneath your skin. It's talking about our carnality, our corrupt nature, our human nature. The flesh is a very powerful thing in a human being. The draw of the flesh, the temptations of the flesh is a very powerful thing. It drives us and it motivates us to do things that we ought not to do. This flesh is overpowering to us. In our own human nature, own form, we can't resist our flesh. We're given over to our flesh. The Apostle Paul, he understood the power of the flesh. Anybody that had been through what Paul had been through and how wonderfully and gloriously saved that Paul was realizes what kind of man he was. But Paul said this long after he'd been saved. He was writing to the Romans and he said this. He said in Romans 7:18, "For I know that in me, that is in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good, I find not." What Paul's saying here is, I realize that in me, there's nothing good in me. If it wasn't for the Lord Jesus Christ, there would be nothing about me any good. My flesh is rotten. I was listening to Brother Frank as he prayed during our offertory, and Frank said he was praying to the Lord and said, "Lord, this old flesh is sick." Friends, our flesh is sick. It is sick. That word lust right there in where it says the lust of the flesh. It's used in our text and it means to desire eagerly, to long after, a depraved carnal desire. A good practical definition of lust is any sinful desire that is contrary to the will of God. Anything that draws you and pulls you that's contrary to God's will is lust. You're lusting after it. Now, of course, we usually think of things being of the sexual nature when it comes to lust. That's the first thing that comes to your mind. It seems the most dominant. But Paul actually gives us a whole list. He actually gives us 17 different things that are of the flesh. Over in Galatians chapter 5, 19 through 24, Paul lists off all these things that are works of the flesh. He said this in Galatians 5 and 19. "Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these." And here we go. The number one, adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft. You Halloween celebrators wearing your witchcraft coming up here tomorrow, the next day. Look at that. Witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Listen, these are things our flesh draws us to do. These are acts. All these things are things that we do because of our rotten carnal flesh. The truth is, this flesh of ours must be kept under subjection. If we don't keep our flesh under subjection and watch ourselves and allow the Lord to lead our lives, the Holy Spirit to guide our lives, we'll be given over to an animal-like condition. We will turn into animals and not human beings. You may say, "Well, that sounds terrible." Listen, my friend, many of y'all will remember just 10 years, well, it'll be 11 years this coming December, but 10 years ago, 3 miles from this church, right here where we're standing right now, you can go out here, go down Babley Road, hit Washington Pike, go all the way across, go past the interstate, keep following Washington Pike toward Broadway. 3 miles from here, you will find where it used to be called Washington Ridge Apartment Complex. They've renamed it now. But 10 years ago, that's what the name of it was. There was two young people that were meeting right there to go on a date. Channon Christian and Christopher Newsom. These two young people were just going out on having a date. They were in love with each other. Young, good people. And there was these other crowd of people that came in looking for trouble. They were looking for a car to steal. That was their, they said was their intention was to carjack someone so that they'd have a car to drive and rob them so they'd have some money to spend. These people were worthless people. And they carjacked these two young people right over here 10 years ago, 3 miles from our church. They drove them another 3 miles. They forced them into their car, bound them up, held them down, and forced them to drive over to Chipman Street, which is just off Cherry Street, which is 6 miles from our church. They took them in a house, and they did such hideous things to them that I can't even speak of the things they did to those two young people. I'm talking brutal, sexual, disgusting, depraved, animal-like behavior that they did to them. Rape, torture, murder, sodomized, beaten, set on fire, placed in bags like garbage and thrown in the trash to die alive, spraying bleach down the throats of the young lady that they tortured. This is what happens to people that are driven by their flesh, by the lust of the flesh. They were lusting after the things of the world. They were desiring to have the things that they didn't have, that their flesh was drawing them to have. And I remember reading the headlines, and it put all their faces across there, all these men and one lady that was involved in these crimes, and they called them animals. Animals. Human beings being referred to as an animal. You know why? Because they were acting in an animal behavior. They were not acting as a human being would act. It's not natural the way they were acting. They were acting out of a depraved, deprived, and inhumane, carnal flesh. Now, that was an extreme case. I understand. I realize that. It's an extreme case. And it's still being drug on today. Their family is still having to go through court appearances and trials where these animals now are trying to get out of their sentences. Some of them had their sentences lightened because there was a problem with the judge that presided over these cases that he was taking drugs at the time. And so some of their sentences were lightened because of legal issues. But these families are still going through the problems and the trials and having to have that brought up before them every single day. The last thing I read about the mother of Christopher Newsom, she said that she's not touched his room since he died. She still has clothes that she folded up and put on the edge of the bed to be put away. They're still there. She's not going to touch them. Every day they live the horrors that has been done to their children because somebody, some people, acted out on the flesh, their carnal nature that's down inside of them. There was nothing godly about any of them. There was no God there. They were just acting in their flesh. As I said, it's extreme. But you listen to me and listen to me well this morning. Just as Paul said to the Romans there, he said, "In my flesh dwelleth no good thing." My friend, you look down into yourself and there is no good thing in your flesh. You say, "Well, I'd never do anything like they did." Oh, hang on a minute. I guarantee you, those boys, these men, they're not boys, they're men, and this lady never thought in their lives that they would ever have done such a thing. Probably 2 years before this happened or a year before it or whatever. I'd say you could went up to them and ask them if they'd ever done anything like that, and they would say, "There's no way I'd do something like that." In fact, when they got on trial, one of them said, "We had no plans to do any of this. It just started happening. We were just going to rob them and take their vehicle and their money." But then one thing led to another, and they went wild. Their flesh drew them. You may be saying, "Yeah, Pastor, I wouldn't do those things that they did to Channon and Christopher." And while I pray to God that's true, that none of us would ever do such a depraved thing, an animal behavior like that, listen, it's in your flesh. It's in your flesh. You are capable of doing anything. Some people say things such as, "Well, I would never do this," or "I would never do that," or they hear somebody that did something, "Oh, I would never do that. I would never cheat on my husband. I'd never cheat on my wife. I would never steal something. I'd never do this. I'd never be homeless. You don't know what's going to happen to you before it's over with. You don't know what you're capable of. And in your flesh, you're capable of anything. You go over to the prison right now and ask these men over there if they ever thought they would have been capable of the crimes that they committed that now has landed them in prison. They never would have thought it. In our opening text, the Bible said that these lusts that we have is not of God. So it's not of the Father, but is of the world. Look at that, verse 16. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the pride of life, is not of the Father, but is of the world. It starts by you loving the things of the world more than you love the things of God. You see, that's the problem. This flesh is in tune with the world. If you can't take Christ out of the life of a person, all we have is our relationship with the world, our flesh and the world. Absent of Christ, that's what we are. Our flesh lusts after more than just things of the sexual nature. Oh, there's many things. It lusts after pleasure and the world's entertainment, through books, through movies, television shows, music. The list goes on and on and on. This flesh is drawn to because it's a crave. It craves things that are not of God. Our flesh is in parallel with God. It's opposite of God. Some things may not be wrong inherently. For instance, maybe music. Music is not wrong, but the wrong kind of music is. Worldly music, satanic music, music that contains lyrics that have bad language and acts described in this music and things. This so-called, what they call it, rap and hip-hop and these things that glorify crime and sex. These things are of the devil. They're not of the Father, they're of the world. And they draw people. Why do you think that these stars have the millions of dollars? Because people are drawn to the things of the world. They're drawn to that. People would certainly go and pay. Who's the guy? Luke Bryan? I hear people talk about this guy named Luke Bryan, country singer. And I've heard his song. They played it on the radio when we was at a store the other day. And I said, that is the awfulest thing I've ever heard in my life. I was at the Rule King, and they were playing it. Now, who in the world is that? That don't sound like country music to me. But people would gladly go and pay $100, $150 to go see this guy sing at one of his concerts, but would complain to give a missionary $5 of their money. Hey, it's the truth, friends. We're drawn by our nature, our flesh, to be drawn after these things. And when it becomes an idol, even though it may not be something bad, when it becomes an idol in your life, when you're drawn to it, and you place this thing above God in your life, then you have lusted, you've been tempted, and you've been drawn into it, and then it becomes sin. The Bible's very clear on how our lust becomes sin. James chapter 1, verses 12 through 15 describes the person and describes this temptation that we go through. Look at it, James 1 and 12. He writes, "Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he's tried, he shall receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to them that love him." Verse 13 says, "Let no man say when he's tempted, I'm tempted of God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. Then when lust has conceived, it bringeth forth sin, and sin, when it is finished, bringeth forth death." That's the progression of our flesh, how our flesh reacts to things, to the world. When you're in love with the world and the things of the world, your flesh craves it and desires it. And when you focus upon it and you want it and you go out to take it, and when you take it and it conceives, and then the lust has been conceived, and then sin has happened. And then sin, the Bible says, leads to death. It always has. Sin leads to death. Which brings us to the second thing in the list that John gives us in our opening text. He says the lust of the eyes. The lust of the eyes. Now, this sounds very much like the same thing as the lust of the flesh. And they're related because the two go hand in hand. But these eyes, one of the greatest gifts that God gave a human being was the ability to be able to see. The things that we see, you ask anybody that once had sight and then lost it, they'll tell you that was the worst thing that ever happened to them, to lose that sight. Now, I know there's cases where somebody said, I'm so glad I lost my sight because now I've been opened up to all these other things, but I guarantee you if they were able to see again in a heartbeat, they would take that eyesight back. God gifted us with the ability to see through these eyes, but our flesh and our eyes cause us to be drawn to sin. With the gift of eyesight comes the ability to see things that draw our flesh. Now, we could go through the Bible and pick out numerous people that we can give an example to, but probably one of the two of the best examples I find in the Bible. Probably the first one I think about is Samson, one of the last judges that God gave of Israel. Blessed man, strong man. God had blessed his man. He was a Nazarite, had a Nazarite vow, had the long hair. The Nazarites wouldn't cut their hair. And he was not supposed to divulge his secret. And he was supposed to live a godly life. And God had blessed him as he did. But then, with these eyes that he had, as he gazed out among the beautiful Philistine woman there, Delilah, as he saw her with those eyes, then his eyes lusted after this woman. She was forbidden. She was a Gentile. He had no business with this woman. But yet, he gave in to the lust of the eyes, and he took her. And he took her as a wife. And we know that God, he was punished because of this. And she betrayed him as he divulged the reason of his strength and told her it was in his hair, and she cut it and then betrayed him and handed him over to the Philistines, and they gouged his eyes out and took him to prison. What an awful, awful thing. And then I think of probably the most notorious lust-filled man that we find in the Bible, the most godly and the most lust-filled, King David. King David. What a great example that we can look at in the Bible. The Bible says that David was a man after God's own heart. What that means is that David loves the things of God. He desires the things of God. David truly was a man of God, but David also gave in to the lust of the eyes and the lust of the flesh. As we see David, as he should have been out on the battlefield with his men, but yet he's stayed behind. He stayed in his own palace. He's lounging around, and he gets up and he wanders and he looks out across the way to the neighbor's house, and there's the beautiful Bathsheba. And with his eyes, he lusted after her. You see, it's not wrong to be tempted. We're all tempted. It's not wrong to be tempted. What becomes wrong is when we give in to the temptation. If David had simply had looked away and walked away and erased that out of his mind and not thought about it again, he would have been fine. But David didn't do that. David looked with his eyes and he lusted after who he saw. And he kept looking and he kept lusting. And that lust, once it became conceived, it turned into sin as he had her come over, committed adultery. And then to cover up his crimes and his sin, he had her husband killed. David's guilty of murder because of that. All because of the lust of the eyes that David, if he had only had his eyes where they needed to be, if his eyes had been on God at that time or on the battle that was at hand, he would not have been looking where he shouldn't have been looking. Friends, we don't want to be looking in places we shouldn't be looking. There are so many temptations out there for these eyes to be tempted of. Because of the sin that caused David's lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the Bible says that God punished him. Over in 2 Samuel 12 and 10, the Bible said, "Now therefore the sword shall never depart from thine house, because thou hast despised me, and hast taken the wife of Uriah the Hittite to be thy wife." David was punished because of this. Not only him, but his family. The sword never departed. He had such a miserable family life after this happened. In the day that we live in today, the access for these eyes to be tempted, to these eyes to be lust, to be drawn by lust, is more greater now than it has ever been. The ability now to draw our fleshly lust. The latest statistics say that in the United States, 84% of households have a computer in the house. Of these homes, 73% of these homes have an internet connection. And 77% of all U.S. citizens own a smartphone with internet access. 77%. That's way up from what it was just about 2 or 3 years ago. It's really grown astronomically. Nowadays, anybody can own a smartphone with internet access. You don't even have to pay the fee for that. You can now just get one and use the Wi-Fi that's now freely given all over the place. You can go to a restaurant, and with their Wi-Fi, you can get on their internet. And so people have access to everything now. At the simple click of a button, at the touch of an icon, a simple keyword typed into a search engine, you now have access. Every man, woman, and child has access to the most depraved, sadistic, evil, disgusting things that you can even imagine. All in the palm of their hand. Everybody has it now. The internet is much like television. It can be used for good or it can be used for bad. For years, we didn't have television. Recently, we got the AT&T thing that where we can get some channels, and we like to watch Brother Lawson. We watch him on Sunday mornings getting ready for church. The Mull Scene Convention's on there, and there's some good things on there. But mixed with the good, there is the bad, the very bad. And it's given out there for everyone to see. And it, unfortunately, the bad now outweighs the good. Let me give you a few of these statistics. And these will probably, you'll probably be very surprised about these. I was. 3 out of 5 divorced couples state that pornography was the cause of their marriage breakdown. 3 out of 5 was the beginning of their marriage breakdown, pornography. 9 out of 10 boys and 6 out of 10 girls are exposed to pornography before they are 18 years old. That means your kids at school are getting exposed to pornography. Schools have internet access. Oh, they block that, Pastor. Oh, you can bet they can get by that. These kids today all have smartphones. They can get on anywhere they want to. 9 out of 10 boys are subject to pornography. 2 out of 5 church-going men admit to regularly viewing pornography several times a week. 2 out of 5. Every second, 28,258 users are watching pornography on the internet. Every second. Every second, $3,075.64 is spent on pornography on the internet. Every second, $3,075. Every second, 372 people are typing the word adult into search engines. Every second. As we've stood here and said, how long have we preached? We've not been preaching for about 15 minutes or so. In that 15 minutes, can you imagine how many people right now have already been typing in and searching and looking at pornography on the internet as we've been standing here? 40 million American people regularly visit porn sites. 35% of all internet downloads are related to pornography. 25% of all search engine queries are related to pornography, or about 68 million searches every day. Porn sites get more visitors each month than Netflix, Amazon, and Twitter combined. Men who view pornography are more likely to show an increased behavioral intent to rape. Search engines get 116,000 queries every day related to child pornography. 34% of internet users have experienced unwanted exposure to pornographic content through ads, pop-ups, and misdirected links or emails. 2.5 billion emails are sent or received every day contain porn. Every 39 minutes, a new pornography video is being created in the United States. Teenage boys who are addicted to internet pornography are less likely to marry or able to maintain a healthy, stable marriage or relationship. The lust of the eyes and the lust of the flesh is an epidemic. Do you know the United States is the number one pornography-driven society in the world? Number one. More pornography is made and watched and downloaded and bought in the United States than anywhere else in the world. One nation under God surfing the internet for porn. It's an epidemic because our flesh is the weakest thing about us. And the devil knows all the right buttons to push. He knows them all. Jesus, in his Sermon on the Mount, addresses the lust of the flesh and the eyes. Listen to what he says in Matthew 5 and 27. He said, "You have heard that it was said by them of old time, thou shalt not commit adultery. But I say unto you that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her has committed adultery with her already in his heart. And if thy right eye offend thee, pluck it out and cast it from thee. For it is profitable for thee that one of thy members should perish, and not that thy whole body should be cast into hell." I wonder today how many young people have access to the internet through their smartphone or through the computer and sit around and viewing this pornography. They're addicted to it, and how that is destroying their lives, and how that now has become their God, and they will never, ever hear about the Lord Jesus Christ. They're not surfing for Highland Baptist Church on the internet, okay? They're not searching for how to be saved on the internet or the gospel of Jesus Christ. They're searching for sex, pornography, nasty, disgusting, evil things. The Bible said, Jesus said, just looking on a woman with lust is equal to committing adultery with her in your heart. Jesus said we would be better off to pluck out our own eyes than to continue in the sin of the lust of the eyes. That's what he said. Then we have the final and third thing, and I'll be quick. In our opening text, John mentions this, the pride of life. One of the greatest examples in the Bible that warns us about the pride of life can go all the way back to the Garden of Eden, to the very beginning of the first man and woman. And you'll find the pride of life. Actually, you find all three of these things there. The lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life are all present in the Garden of Eden. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, the Bible says, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden. But of the fruit of the tree, which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it. Neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, you shall not surely die. For God doth know that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be open, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. Do you see it? She saw the tree was good for food, the lust of the flesh. She saw that it was pleasant to the eyes, the lust of the eyes. And then she saw that it would make her wise, the pride of life. The pride of life is anything that leads to our arrogance, our boasting, our pride, our self, our presumption, and pride wanting to be lifted up and exalted above others, or on equal terms with others. Here, Adam and Eve thought they could be on equal terms with God, that they could be gods themselves. They could have the wisdom that God had. And in their pride of life, they decided they would go ahead and sin against God so they could be like a god. Their pride was their downfall. We see this same sin in the builders of the Tower of Babel. As they were there building that tower up into the heavens, they wouldn't build it to talk to God. They were building it so they could be seen by the world and say, look what we did. Look who we are. Look what we accomplished. They wanted the attention of the world. They wanted their pride to be exalted. They wanted to be lifted up and seen for someone. It was their pride that destroyed them. God came down and saw what they were doing, confounded their language, and ended all that. It was their pride. Our pride does things to us. We want to drive the nicest car, wear the nicest suit, have the nicest house, you know, everything. We want to have everything better than everybody else. We think that our kids are better than your kids. Our family is better than your family. The way that we think, the way that we do is much better than yours. And so we want to be lifted up and exalted in our lives. Everything's got to be better. We become very proud, prideful, and it leads to sin. Listen, things that are innocent, your children, are gifts of God. But when you put those children up on a pedestal and you put them up as your idols, your pride has now been exalted, and it's a sin. When you put your children in front of God, it's a sin. Now, people don't want to hear that, but it's the truth. Pride of life leads us to lust for recognition, fancy titles, the head of the office, something to make us feel superior than everyone else. These things are what the devil uses against us. He pushes those buttons. He always has and he always will. We talked about it in Sunday school this morning where the Spirit took Jesus up to be tempted of the devil. And it says in Matthew 4:1, then was Jesus led up to the Spirit in the wilderness to be tempted of the devil. And when he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was afterward had hungered. And when the tempter came to him, he said, if thou be the Son of God, command that these stones be made bread. He was going after the lust of the flesh. Make these stones bread. Jesus was hungry after he'd fasted 40 days and 40 nights. Hey, if you're the Son of God, make these stones bread and eat. Trying to draw his flesh. But he answered and said, it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. Then the devil taketh him up into the holy city and setteth him up on the pinnacle of the temple and saith unto him, if thou be the Son of God, cast thyself down, for it is written, he shall give his angels charge concerning thee, and in their hands they shall bear thee up, lest at any time thou dash thy foot against a stone. He was tempting him with the pride of life. Listen, if you are who you say you are, lift yourself up and do this and do that, and you can have all of this. He's trying to get his pride built up. Now, us in our flesh, we'd have certainly said, you better believe I'm the Son of God. I scared everybody in the Sunday school class this morning. I said, boom! We would have just destroyed the devil. We'd have destroyed everything. And then Jesus said unto him, it is written again, thou shalt not tempt the Lord thy God. Again, the devil taketh him up into exceeding high mountain, showeth him all the kingdoms of the world and the glory of them, and said unto him, all these things will I give thee, if thou wilt fall down and worship me. He's trying to tempt Jesus in the lust of the eyes. Look out on all this world. Look at all that. And his pride was there too. You can have all of this. You can be exalted above all. You can have it all. Stupid devil. It already belonged to him. It already belonged to the Lord. But yet he tried to tempt him. And Jesus said unto him, get thee hence, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Then the devil leaveth him, and behold, angels came and ministered unto him. All three of these things that we've been talking about this morning were present in the temptation of Christ: lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, and the pride of life. Now, the question is this morning, I've gave you an awful lot of deep things, a lot of heavy things to think about. The question is, what can we do about it? How can we keep ourselves from getting into these things of the world that draw us and draw our flesh and draw our eyes and puff up our pride? How do we handle all this? Turn quickly over to the book of Galatians. Galatians chapter 5. We'll be finished. Galatians chapter 5, Paul writing to the church there at Galatia. And he's dealing with the same problem. And he's trying to help this church so that they can understand how they are to live and not be tempted by these things, or at least how they're able to combat these things. Galatians 5 and 16. Paul says, this I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusteth against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. But if you be led of the Spirit, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. And we've read these off, these 17 things: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. What's the answer? I think it's pretty clear. Paul says right here, hey, if you want to keep yourself out of the things of the flesh, out of the lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life, walk in the Spirit. Get that other stuff out of your life. You can't walk in the Spirit and walk in the world at the same time. Sister Alma was saying this morning in Sunday school class, she saw a sign that said you can't walk with the devil and walk with God at the same time, and you can't do it. We got to rid ourselves of these things that cause our flesh to be tempted. If your problem is internet pornography, get rid of it. Get it out of your life. Get a safeguard. Download a program that every time that you try it, it warns you or warns somebody. Get somebody to help you with it. Because it's an addiction. It's a sin is what it is. It becomes an addiction. But it's sin. Don't just dispel it as, oh, I'm addicted to something. I just need a drug to help me. No, you need Jesus to help you. You need the Holy Spirit to help you. Paul said, walk in the Spirit. That'll help you with these things. If you're drawn by other things, the lust of the eyes, if things are drawing you, or the pride of life is something in your life that you're just driving at every day to try to be better than everybody else, to be lifted up and exalted, be seen, deal with it through the Lord. Ask the Lord to help me with this. The Bible says we are to humble ourselves in the presence of God. So there is an answer for us. There is an answer for these people that are into these things that's causing their marriages to fall apart and their families to be ripped apart and being put into prison. All these things can be avoided if we only live in the Spirit of God. Get the world out. Hey, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. The love of the world, it's not the love of the Father. The Father's not in it. It's of the world. I'm going to ask them to come get the invitation song this morning. I don't know what you may be dealing with today. I don't know what your draw is. I don't know what the thing is that draws you to be tempted or to cause you to sin or the sin that so easily besets you, but you're aware of it. You know it. And not only do you know it, but God knows it. And until we get that thing out of our lives, it will always be a stumbling block to you. You'll never live the Spirit-filled life or the victorious life that Christ would have you to live as long as that sin is in your life. As we stand this morning, I'm going to pray. And if you need help with something, you come to this altar, whether it be to be saved, if you've never been saved, or if you thought you were saved and realized you wasn't, would you come down this morning and let me talk to you through the Word of God and pray with you and see what we can do about that. If you're backslidden today, come down to the altar and pray. If you're dealing with some problem in your life and you need help, come down and pray this morning. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come to you, Lord, just asking for your help. Lord, the word's gone out. God, we've preached what you put on our heart to preach today. And God, we're trusting in you to help us with it. God, this flesh of ours, just as Brother Frank said, Lord, it's sick. Lord, it's rotten. It's carnal. It's not of the Father. But God, it's of the world. Lord, I'm asking for your help. If anybody in here today that's dealing with a problem, whether it be lost, if they need to be saved, God, if they need to be rededicated, God, if they need help with the struggle they're going through, would this be the day, Lord, that you have them come to the altar this morning and make things right? Help us, Father. Help us. Keep praying, friends. If you need help, come to the altar.